So, anyway, for what it's worth, but perhaps.
Yeah. committee will come to order, and I apologize to all my colleagues for being late. My bad, you show up on time, there's no reason for me to be late. Today, we're going to talk about something that is, I'm by no means an expert on, but I'm very curious about, and that is 5G networks, their development here at home and abroad, and particularly in China. What does it mean to the average American? What threats do we face from these networks being purchased by our allies from China? Where are we at in developing the technology? So I really appreciate the witnesses. The first witness on panel one will be Christopher Krebs, the Director of Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency for the Department of Homeland Security. Mr. Robert Stryer is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Cyber and International Communications and Information Policy at the State Department. Then we'll have some private sector witnesses. And I look forward to learning and trying to find out how Congress can help solve whatever problems we have. And with that, I'll turn it over to Senator Feinstein.
Thanks very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for holding this hearing. I actually know very little about 5G.
Me too.
I've tried to learn. And what we see is a transition to some fifth generation wireless technology, and that's 5G. And what I'm told is it's going to fundamentally change our society, our economy, and our national security. So we all need to be concerned. I'm told it's expected to provide exponential increases in speed, capacity, and reliability of internet-connected devices. That will include a variety of revolutionary technologies, from new methods of transmitting data to new advanced cell tower infrastructure and an untold number of new smart devices. I'm told 5G is expected to provide not only 20 times faster network performance, but also generate $12.3 trillion in global sales activity by 2035. I'm told it's going to create millions of new jobs and launch entirely new industries. However, 5G also represents serious consequences for our national security. So I think it's very critical to understand and explore those issues as well. And all of this is the purpose of today's hearing. I thought FBI Director Wray said it well when he said this: 5G technology provides the capacity to exert pressure or control over our telecommunications infrastructure. It provides capacity to maliciously modify or steal information. And it provides capacity to conduct undetected espionage. Undetected espionage. Because of its economic and security implications, the race to 5G has elicited fierce competition among companies and governments around the world. 5G is a national strategic priority of China. The Chinese government has invested more than $400 billion in development. It has supported Chinese industry efforts in international standard-setting bodies. It has allocated domestic spectrum for 5G. It has supported deployment of over 350,000 5G stations in China, which is nearly 10 times as many as are deployed in the United States. Huawei alone has grown its global revenue from $28 billion in 2009 to $107 billion in 2018. 1 year ago, Huawei held 28% of the global telecommunications market, up 4% from 2015 alone. Today, 59% of all handsets sold in India are Chinese made. However, the root of our concerns with Chinese companies like Huawei is not their growth, but requirements placed on them by the Chinese government. According to a recent letter from Admirals Stavridis, Breedlove, Lockyer, Keating, General Clapper, and General Alexander, China's 2017 intelligence law requires all Chinese companies, and I quote, to support, assist, and cooperate with the security services of China's one-party state, end quote. The letter further states, and I quote, the Chinese cybersecurity law and other national strategies like military-civil fusion mean that nothing Chinese firms do can be independent of the state. Firms must support the law enforcement, intelligence, and national security interests of the Chinese Communist Party, a system fundamentally antithetical to the privacy and security of Chinese citizens and all those using Chinese networks overseas. So, exactly what does that mean? I think that's a crucial question in this because this is so big. I visited China for 40 years. Assuming the interpretation of this law is correct, I find this deeply troubling, and I think every nation ought to think long and hard about the consequences of opening their internal telecommunications networks to this kind of data extraction and potential espionage. So we need to lead, but with caution. And so as a member of the Intelligence Committee for a long time now, and other members of this committee join me in that, I really view, Mr. Chairman, this hearing as just a beginning. This is revolutionary, and we must know well all its aspects.
This is why I have a flip phone. Nobody can get in it. Mr. Krebs.
Chairman Graham, Ranking Member Feinstein, and members of the committee, thank you for today's opportunity to testify on efforts to enhance the security of fifth-generation mobile communications network, or 5G. At DHS's Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, or CISA, we lead the national effort to safeguard and secure federal networks and critical infrastructure from cyber and physical threats. In this sense, we serve as the nation's risk advisor. The communication sector is an integral component of the U.S. economy and our national security, underlying the operations of all businesses, public safety, and government. It provides an enabling function across virtually all critical infrastructure sectors. Advances in 5G will support greater bandwidth, capacity for billions of sensors and smart devices that make up the Internet of Things, and ultra-low latency necessary for highly reliable critical communications. Autonomous vehicles, critical manufacturing, medical doctors practicing remote surgery, and a smart electric grid represent a small fraction of the technologies and economic activity that 5G will support. Every day, my agency, CISA, works with our federal partners, wireless and wireline carriers, and other private sector companies to strengthen the security of both existing and new technologies so we can collectively realize the benefits that they offer. There's no doubt that there will be a broad, diverse range of possible risks associated with 5G technologies, threatening to exploit the integrity, confidentiality, and availability of data, as well as the critical functions that data enables. To ensure we're positioned to manage those risks, we've established a 5G working group within CISA that brings together our relevant expertise in emergency preparedness communications, cybersecurity, supply chain risk management, and infrastructure security. This group works closely with our industry partners as well as coordinates on both tactical and strategic risk management efforts alongside the Department of Justice, FBI, State, NTIA, NIST, the FCC, DOD, and the intelligence community. We are working with partners in industry to establish a common baseline understanding of 5G deployments by which we can guide risk management priorities. As a part of this, we are taking a risk-based approach to understanding the implications of the growing global presence of Chinese telecom equipment throughout the 5G technology stack. The potential for Chinese intelligence and security services to use Chinese firms as routine and systemic espionage platforms against the United States and our allies is concerning, and a potential direct threat to our mandate to ensure national security and emergency preparedness communications. Supply chain security is critical to managing risk, and we are working with partners in government and industry to enhance our risk management efforts. The National Defense Authorization Act of 2019 included a provision that generally prohibits federal agencies from procuring or contracting with entities that use telecommunications equipment produced by Huawei, ZTE, or entities that are controlled by the Chinese government. The Federal Acquisition Regulations Council is currently developing regulations to implement that law. With the enactment of the Federal Acquisition Supply Chain Security Act, the federal government now has a dedicated interagency body with appropriate acquisition authorities to take action on technology supply chain matters, including 5G. The Secretaries of Homeland Security, Defense, and the Director of National Intelligence now have authority to issue government-wide removal orders to address supply chain risks when necessary. And we have established a mechanism to collaborate with industry experts. Our Supply Chain Risk Management Task Force has brought together 20 federal partners and 40 of the most significant companies in the IT and communication sector to reach consensus on how to best manage risk. CISA also participates in interagency efforts like CFIUS and Team Telecom. DHS represents critical infrastructure sectors on CFIUS, including information technology and communications. We assess risks posed by transactions and engage with our partners on the disposition of acquisitions. Research and development is also critical to our mission. Last month, we announced a project for innovative approaches to protect legacy, current, and 5G mobile network communications. Before closing, I want to emphasize that our success will depend on engagement with international allies. CISA regularly engages with international partners on a range of cyber and communications sector risks. Notably, as my colleague from the State Department will discuss further, earlier this month in Prague, we attended an international expert conference on the security of 5G and future communications networks. Ultimately, our goal, our vision, is to enable that broader collective defense against cybersecurity threats, where the government and industry understand the risks we face and are prepared to defend against them. Once again, thank you for the opportunity to appear today, and I look forward to your questions.
Chairman Graham, Ranking Member Feinstein, and members of the committee, thank you for today's opportunity to testify. I'm going to summarize my testimony, so I'd ask that my entire written statement be included in the record. Thank you. As the world becomes more interconnected, international cyber policy issues are becoming even more critical to our national security, human rights, and economic prosperity. The State Department promotes U.S. foreign policy interests in cyberspace by engaging with our allies and partners to advance our vision for an open, interoperable, reliable, and secure digital environment. With the fifth generation of wireless technology, or 5G, a number of new critical services will be empowered, as Mr. Krebs just mentioned. But these will also include traditional critical infrastructure, such as electricity distribution. The massive amounts of data transmitted by Internet of Things devices on 5G networks will also advance artificial intelligence. With all the critical services relying on 5G networks, the stakes for safeguarding them could not be higher. As countries around the world upgrade their communication systems to 5G technology, we are urging them to adopt a risk-based security framework. To this end, the Department is executing a global campaign on 5G security that includes strategic bilateral and multilateral engagements to convince our allies and partners of the need to adequately secure these networks. An important element of this risk-based security approach is a careful evaluation of hardware and software equipment vendors and their supply chains. The evaluation criteria should include whether vendors are subject to control by a foreign government with no meaningful checks and balances on its power to compel cooperation of these vendors with its intelligence and security agencies. Because of the essential role that vendors play in networks and their maintenance, they can be ordered to undermine network security, to steal personal information or intellectual property, conduct espionage, disrupt critical services, or conduct cyber attacks. Under Chinese law, as the ranking member mentioned, notably its national intelligence law, Chinese citizens and organizations are required to cooperate with Chinese intelligence and security services. In addition, the Chinese government does not have any meaningful checks or balances on its power. As President Xi Jinping told security officials in January, China does not walk the Western road of constitutionalism, separation of powers, or judicial independence. Therefore, we are concerned that China could compel actions by network vendors to act against the interests of our citizens or citizens of other countries around the world. Chinese technology firms are already working with authoritarian regimes, often hand in hand with the Chinese government, to suppress freedom of expression and other human rights through arbitrary surveillance, censorship, and targeted restrictions on internet access. If Chinese companies build the underlying 5G infrastructure, they will be in an even better place to facilitate these activities in the future. In addition, China has a long history of undertaking intellectual property theft to benefit its commercial interests. Last December, the United States announced that since at least 2014, Chinese cyber actors associated with the Chinese Ministry of State Security hacked multiple U.S. and global cloud service providers. This allowed them access to the networks of global companies in more than 12 different countries. Nations should not allow 5G to be another vector for China to steal their intellectual property. The United States will be a leader in 5G deployment, and we will do so using trusted vendors to build our networks. Through our engagements, many other countries are now acknowledging the supply chain risk and beginning to strengthen their security alongside the United States. For example, in March, the European Union's Commission released a set of recommendations to improve the cybersecurity of 5G networks, noting that evaluations of equipment suppliers should include, quote, the risk of influence by a third country, notably in relation to its model of governance. This principle should be applied rigorously. 2 weeks ago, the Czech Republic hosted more than 140 representatives from 32 countries, including the United States, as well as the European Union and NATO. We were there to build consensus on a common approach to 5G security. This effort produced the Prague Principles, a set of recommendations on how to build secure and resilient 5G networks based on free and fair competition, transparency, and the rule of law. Moving forward, the Prague Proposals will help guide our engagements with our partners and allies to build secure 5G networks. We will continue our bilateral and multilateral engagements to ensure that telecommunications, the internet, and all the critical services that 5G will enable are secure and reliable. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before the committee today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you both. The criteria you just talked about, we're telling our allies you need to make sure that these products are safe and secure, for lack of a better way of saying it. Is that correct?
Correct.
Under the criteria you've just outlined and under the opening statement given by Dianne Feinstein, Senator Feinstein, based on the way China does business, how could an ally possibly buy anything from China and live within the criteria?
Well, we want them to adopt a risk-based framework that includes...
But if they adopt the risk-based framework, they're not buying from China. Do you agree with that, Mr. Krebs? Is this your policy?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's why we have hearings. Now, so what are we saying? We're telling the world, if you buy Chinese 5G stuff, you're not doing business with us. Seems to me that we need to up our 5G game, because if there's nobody other than China, we got a problem. Do you agree with that?
There are other vendors out there. We think notably that Nokia and Ericsson and Samsung.
People that can meet alternatives, the criteria.
Alternatives to China, right, that are not under the control potentially of an authoritarian
regime. So is it fair to say we're trying to put China's 5G efforts out of business because of the way they do business?
That's not our goal, but we want our...
Isn't that the result?
It will.
I'm fine with that being the result if they're doing all the things you say. I just want China to know where we stand. What do you say?
I don't think that's an economic reality. I think.
But what would they need to do? They need to change the way they do business, right?
It's a fundamental difference in the way we look at governance, sovereignty, values.
The criteria is to stop being China. Under its current form. Isn't that a simple message?
Their private sector is an extension of the government.
So
this
what
is
you're
digital
saying, I want everybody to understand, if you're an ally of the United States, these criteria that we're asking you to consider, there is no way in hell China can meet those criteria because of the way they govern. So the policy of the United States, Democrats and Republicans, I hope, will be that if you buy their stuff, because of the way they do business, you're going to lose access to information technology coming from America. Is that a fair statement given where we are today?
I would only say that we have to protect our information. If there's a high degree of risk, which we think that these vendors create in the system, then we will have to reassess how we're sharing that information in the future with our partners.
Well, if you buy it, we're not going to give it to you.
Right. Well, we will reassess that.
Thank you.
It's interesting to me because right now both the heads of Qualcomm and Broadcom are residents of California, and that was the battle over the 5G chip, I guess. And where this all goes is I think, has to be really reduced to the level of everyday understanding, Mr. Chairman.
I'm there.
Because, let me ask a question. Isn't it true that original manufacturers of backbone telecom equipment often maintain connections with that equipment in order to provide routine maintenance? But those back channels could be used to insert malicious software virtually undetected. Is that correct?
It's absolutely true. And in fact, it can occur on a daily basis. There's updates to that software.
Would you agree with that?
Yes,
Mr.
ma'am.
Krebs?
Technically, yes, ma'am.
So the question comes, for somebody like me, I begin to question the whole 5G thing because it creates a situation that can be used to do tremendous harm. And that's the invasion and the removal. What do we do about that?
That's why we need trusted vendors to be part of that ecosystem. You need to be able to trust the partner to patch vulnerabilities, not intentionally insert malicious code into those updates.
Mr. Krebs?
Yes, ma'am, I agree with that. We adopted a similar approach a couple years ago when we issued a directive to remove Kaspersky Anti-Lab antivirus products from U.S. federal networks. We took a look at what the issue was. It was an antivirus product that had broad access to machines below a level at which we monitor. That data was then sent back to Moscow for further analysis, along with the other machines deployed globally. And given the system of laws in Russia, much like in China, the intelligence and military services had unfettered access to that data. So potentially you had a situation where the military and intelligence services had access to federal networks. That's an untenable risk management position. We issued exclusion orders. That is a similar framework that we can use in this case, whether it's 5G, whether it's any sort of telephony or ICT technology. We need to have a framework within which we can evaluate risk. And if it is a persistent access question, like you've laid out, that is an issue I'm going to be very concerned about.
Well, I believe it is, and I think we should be very concerned. And I think we should be concerned about the Chinese law that makes this permissible. And I think it should become a major element of State Department policy also to try to straighten this out before we proceed and have real problems. Because Huawei has been very assertive. As a member of the Intelligence Committee, I've heard from individual CEOs about importunings. And this is a very big deal because it could make our country incredibly vulnerable. And we cannot let China do this. It's that simple. I appreciate your comment.
We agree with that. It's a top priority. It's a top priority for Secretary Pompeo. He's raising it in countries around the world. We're doing hundreds of engagements around the world with our partners and allies to raise this issue with them. It's one of our top priorities.
Yes, ma'am. I agree. We are doing a significant amount of outreach and engagement with the American critical infrastructure community, how they engage with China, both operating in that market and how they partner with them, and sharing information as best we can. I think we have to keep in mind that really the dawning of the Chinese threat from an intelligence community and a risk management community perspective really came into focus just over the last 2 years. So we're making up a significant amount of ground. But I am seeing progress. I am seeing America's businesses take a different position as they view China as both a market and a partner. And I think that trend will only continue.
Is there pressure for China to change the law?
Ma'am, I don't think the law matters. I think this is a single-party government, that everything that flows from the central party is a manifestation of their philosophy. So the law is important because it's telling you what they do, but they're going to get what they want anyway, law or not.
Yeah, Senator, we agree with that. We're concerned about the national intelligence law from 2017, but we would agree that in the system that they have in China, there's not an independent judiciary. No company can object and say, I don't want to follow the mandate of Xi Jinping. It's one party, state, communist rule, and they have to follow the dictates of that government. And so we think it's fundamentally different than any type of Western vendor's governance structure that they're controlled by.
Well, then, last question. Yes, ma'am. Until it's clear and decisive, should we move ahead with making 5G available in this country?
It's important. In our country, all four of the major carriers have confirmed they are not going to use Chinese technology to build their 5G network. So we are going to be secure in the United States. We're talking to our partners and allies about not using it in their networks. That's where the big challenge remains.
Thank you.
I agree with that 100%. I think we have to continue moving forward. The big four have committed. We do need to work closer. I just had a briefing yesterday with the rural telecommunications companies. You know, they have some economic realities that we have to help them out on. Huawei does have a product that at times is more not necessarily life cycle cost effective, but it comes in the door a little bit cheaper on the response to the RFP. Plus, they provide a fully integrated stack, which is an attractive to a smaller organization. So we need to take a harder look at that. But ultimately, I think where we're going is if the U.S. continues on the path that we are on, by 2025, we will have the broadest adoption of 5G anywhere in the world. The faster we can get to 5G, the more we will be able to hit the innovation layer, and that's above the core and the RAN, the radio access and the core. That's going to be where all the innovation and advancement comes, is on what rides on top of 5G.
Thank you.
Senator Sayas.
Mr. Chairman, thanks for scheduling this hearing. I think short of a digital Pearl Harbor, it's really hard for people to get their heads around what we're talking about here, and I don't think there's any more critical issue that the Congress should be devoting attention to than this. So thank you for scheduling this, and to both of you for being here. Could each of you, in less than 60 seconds apiece, explain to Americans why the jump from 4G to 5G? Well, first of all, what is it? Explain what 4G to 5G technology change is, and how exponentially does that expand our threat surface?
I'll start. So with the transformation from 4G, we've been mostly thinking about how we communicate with over the internet, using our smartphones and telecommunications and internet connectivity that's achieved that way. 5G is going to be about machine-to-machine communication, the Internet of Things. So we'll see things in power like telemedicine, autonomous transportation networks, automated manufacturing, as well as the communications need to occur to make our critical infrastructure even work in the first place. So what makes the stakes so high is that a disruption to that underlying 5G network will disrupt all of those critical services. That's why this is so fundamentally different and so much more important that we get the security right, because even availability is now a very critical issue.
So the jump from 3 to 4G went from people having Lindsay's phone, a flip phone, you know, regularly smashed on TV in debates, to a 1.5G for the chairman.
Lindsay doesn't have a G.
So when you went to smartphones with all the apps that are layered on top of that, that's an exponential change. It's not linear. Are you saying that 4 to 5 is the same sort of exponential change again?
Without question.
Secretary Krebs, how would you summarize it?
So I agree with everything that Ambassador Strayer said, and I'll add that if the height of 4G LTE technology is ride sharing and ride hailing apps, and if you lost that signal, you know, you wouldn't, half your staff wouldn't know how to get from meeting to meeting. When we talk about 5G, we're not talking about hailing a car. We're talking about autonomous vehicles not being able to operate, about telemedicine. This moves from a data confidentiality issue to a life safety issue where things won't work as designed, whether the market or the signal's up or down.
Okay, so now reconcile for us two things which seem to be in tension. One is when we meet with our allies, they tell us lots of them have to be installing Huawei or allowing Huawei in their supply chain because no other vendors can compete. And simultaneously, you say that the four major carriers in the US have committed that they're not gonna use Huawei stuff. How do we reconcile the two? Why do the Europeans think they need Huawei, and we say we're going to be able to advance without it domestically?
So on one hand, I think you have an economic reality situation where there are only so many vendors available with only so many production runs, and in some cases there is additional financing that comes along with it that may be soft financing or low to no cost financing. So the attractiveness of a Huawei or other ZT or whatever it is that's particularly subsidized by the government, it just makes it easier for some of these governments that may not be able to invest at the upfront. One of the arguments that, not to steal Rob's talking points here, but one of the stories that we, or the message we continue to push, is you have to look at the total life cycle cost. Recently, the UK has issued, if you haven't read it yet, I highly recommend, but the Huawei Oversight Board Security Evaluation Center report on Huawei They have 20 years, 15 to 20 years of experience, real-time, in the network, working with Huawei, and it's a pretty damning report as I read it. The quality of the product's not great. The existence of vulnerabilities, just the ability to understand what is happening on the networks, it's just not there. So these are costs that are going to pile up over a 10 to 15-year period.
Ambassador.
Yeah, I would just add on the cost front that over time, if those countries continue to build out Huawei equipment in their 5G networks, because there'll be so many more towers and points of presence, that'll make it that much harder down the road to make the right decision and turn the page. So that if they do experience espionage or disruption of services, it'll be too late to turn back. This is the time to act to make a decision about how to migrate away from that kind of untrusted vendor. And they don't have to do it overnight. We're not asking them to rip it out of the ground today. We're saying find a pathway to make yourself secure, secure for all of our sakes, both our joint economic relationships and our important security relationships.
So I've heard some of our NATO allies, heads of state, essentially say Huawei is both higher quality and lower cost than anything else they can buy right now. Is that true? Who are the other? Go through Ericsson, Nokia, Samsung. How far behind are they, or is that statement not true?
It's just not true. Our 5G rollouts in our telcos is going to lead the world, and they're using only those other vendors. So they don't need to wait for Chinese technology. They're going to lead with those three vendors, Samsung, Nokia, and Ericsson, in the rollout. It's just fundamentally not true that we should have to wait. There might be economic considerations. We hear that maybe it's up to 15% cheaper on the front end, but as Mr. Krebs just mentioned, the long-term lifecycle cost, when there's, as the UK found, hundreds of vulnerabilities in the software, you have to constantly patch that. That patching, that disruption to your system over time is not worth the cost. It makes the cost longer in the long run.
In keeping in mind that the UK government set up a dedicated oversight mechanism to monitor Huawei equipment in their networks, and Huawei has not demonstrated in a 10-year period any improvement in their security engineering process. They're still doing the things they said they were going to fix 10 years ago. They've promised a transformation program, putting $2 billion against it. There's no plan. There has been no change yet. I think the premise that you can establish an oversight monitoring board, A, it's just not cost effective, too, and what's it going to get you? Again, actions speak louder than words here, and we're just not seeing the follow through globally.
We're at time, so let me just say thank you to both of you, but I want to underscore two things as the hearing proceeds today. Number one, I hope we talk more about how security updates will work in a big data world, because we can't really envision right now how the world's going to change, pardon me, between 5 and 10, and 10 and 15 years with the uses of big data. And so when you're having the cyclical relationship between the data and the updates, there's no way these oversight boards are possibly going to be run by governments. They're going to be fast enough and competent enough to deal with a machine learning and an AI environment to know whether or not you're being exploited. And number two, Secretary Krebs, I just want to underscore the point you made in your opening statement, that fundamentally the private sector in China is an extension of the government. And so if our allies decide to trust Huawei, they're deciding to trust the Chinese government with their big data.
I just would like to echo that. It's not about overseeing Huawei, it's about overseeing China. And if I were a NATO member, I would get a copy of this hearing and listen to it. I haven't seen bipartisan leadership like this in a long time. Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Along those lines, I guess I'll start with you, Ambassador. China, if we look at taking it outside of this particular technology, they are taking a comprehensive approach to ensuring their edge, and that includes attempts to control the international standard setting process for new technologies. The written testimony of Dr. Lewis, who's a witness on the next panel, notes that representatives from China's state-owned enterprises and other Chinese government-backed firms are trying to shape the agenda and outcomes in standard-setting organizations for key technologies like 5G and the Internet of Things. What is the State Department doing to ensure that international setting, standard setting processes are politically neutral?
Thanks for that question, Senator. It's a great question.
Okay.
So we're through the U.S. government at the Commerce Department, the NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, is a member of the Third Generation Partnership Project,
right,
which is the body that's helping define standards. So we need to remain vigilant to ensure that we're having the process determined by what is the best ideas and the best technology solutions rather than the political decisions that the top-down framework that the Chinese would rather have. There's an organization at the UN called the International Telecom Union. In that, State Department leads in our engagements there. We do that with a range of private sector. We ensure that we're going to those meetings, putting forth the best ideas and ensuring that we're not going to have a process governed by politics based on science and substance.
And are we working with allies on this, given some of these issues that have been raised here?
Absolutely. We have a broad engagement with our allies as we go into all of these. We work in regional settings, most closely with the Western Hemisphere states at this UN body, as well as with all of our partners in Europe.
And Director Krebs, what can other governments and foreign companies do to prevent national governments like China from skewing this standard-setting process to serve their own interests?
Participate. Okay. Absolutely participate. I think one of the things we're saying, well, I on my team, I have subject matter experts that participate in the 3GPP process, travel all around the world on a regular basis to engage in these conversations to make sure, particularly from an emergency communications and priority services perspective. But we have to, governments have to take pride in their representation. I think in some cases we're seeing Chinese, you know, it's one country, one vote, but it's not necessarily the government that's providing the vote. In some cases, it's the company on behalf of the country. And sometimes the company is a Chinese company in a country that's voting on behalf of that country. So, again, take pride, represent your country.
Okay, very good. Ambassador, some of my other colleagues asked you about how we can mitigate these threats and the some of the other countries that are using Huawei. If our allies and our international partners fail to safeguard their networks from foreign intrusions, how could it compromise the security of U.S. networks, 5G networks?
Well, first of all, there's a concern about our very sensitive intelligence information, other critical information that we're sharing. We don't want that to be lost. We don't want that to be compromised. You know, more data flows between the United States and Europe than anywhere else on the planet. So as we have increasingly intertwined economies and supply chains, a disruption of 5G that disrupts their economy is going to have an almost immediate effect on our shores as well, and the supply chains and ability to access products and services. So that's why it's very important that we ensure that even their networks, for their own citizens' benefit, are secure, but it's also to our benefit to ensure that they're secure as well.
Okay.
The one thing I really want to underscore here is the actual availability of the network. So if it's a mission in Europe or a mission in Africa or elsewhere, if it's riding on a commercial network that's supported by Huawei, the availability and the ability of that mission or the Department of Defense to operate, the actual availability to run command and control, if they control the network, they control whether we can communicate. At that point, who cares whether they're listening in? They can control whether we can connect dots. Mm-hmm. It's increasingly about availability of the networks.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I think we got two votes. Let's keep going as long as we can and see if we can get through the hearing here. It's a very important hearing. Senator Hawley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for calling this hearing, which I think is extremely important. We are, I think it's time we admitted, in the middle of a technological arms race with China. And I think it's important to underscore that China is not just one threat among many. China is the national security threat facing this country now and perhaps for many, many years to come. And we are in many ways at a serious disadvantage. I was struck by something you said, Director Krebs, that really it's only in the last 2 years that we have woken up to across this government the serious security threat that China poses to us across a range of fronts. And we are making up for lost time. And one area where we're making up for lost time is I think too many U.S. companies have been unthinkingly transferring sensitive technology to China. And then that technology ends up in the hands of the Chinese government and the Chinese military. And this simply has to stop, which is why this morning I've introduced the China Technology Transfer Control Act, which calls for placing China's core technologies on the Commerce Department's export control list and for sanctions on foreign entities and individuals who help U.S. businesses skirt these export controls. We need to stop fighting yesterday's war when it comes to getting at not only how China steals U.S. technology, but also American ideas and American innovation. And this truly is, I think, the next frontier in our fight for our national security. Ambassador, let me just invite you to comment on efforts like this. What more do we need to do to make sure that our most sensitive technology does not end up in the hands of the Chinese military?
Well, I think your legislation seems to be hitting in an area where we're very concerned and thinking very carefully about that. And you might be aware that under the previous law, the Export Control Reform Act, Congress directed the Commerce Department to conduct a process which started last November to look at dual-use technologies that are important to our national security and consider whether export control regulations should apply to them. So that process is continuing. I think it's something that we really need to focus on. Of course, we want to make sure that technology is available for our companies to be able to innovate wherever they want to do so around the globe, but we also don't want to see it in the hands of authoritarian governments or nation states that want to take that technology and move it to government facilitated ends. So I think we got to look very closely at that.
Director, do you want to add to that at all? Do you have other thoughts?
I think that's right. I think you know, as we look at China, and these are not my words, they're one of a pretty significant investor, but companies are increasingly have to understand that China is probably three things. One, it's an opportunity. It's a market. They can go in and they can sell something in that market. Two, is a partner. They can do R&D. They can do technology development. And the third is, simply put it, they're a threat, strategic threat from stealing IP, forced technology transfer. I think on the first one is the opportunity. Companies are starting to come to grips with that market's not what they thought it was. That market is not what they were told it was, principally because in China, you're only as successful as the government lets you be. And as soon as you're no longer of use to them, then they tamp down and you're out. On the partner side, that's, I think, where there's a lot of the concern I have. Universities are a great example of shared R&D partnerships, sensitive technologies that are being developed collaboratively. We've talked about AI and big data. You know, these tools are being taken back to China and allowing them to implement a form of digital authoritarianism. That is simply not congruent with our values as a democracy. And increasingly, I think that's where we're going. We're seeing companies that are looking at markets through the lens of, are they an autocratic authoritarian state or are they a democracy? I can play ball in one, but I can't in the other.
You know, you make a fantastic point about digital authoritarianism. China has built the most unbelievably perfect authoritarian regime in many ways that the world has ever seen. It's horrifying. And when it comes to markets, I think we need to send the signal to American companies that they have a choice to make when they think of China as a market, that there is no just going into China and investing and sharing technologies with Chinese companies and thinking that that's not somehow going to benefit the authoritarian Chinese state. It is going to benefit the authoritarian Chinese state. It is going to reinforce the Chinese military. It is going to be, those technologies are going to be weaponized quite literally. And American companies, I think, have to make a choice about where their loyalties lie. Is it with the free and open international system? Is it with American security? Or is it with what China is trying to do? Let me just ask you this in the short time that we have remaining. Director, let me just start with you. Let's go back to the threat that Huawei ZTE pose. What opportunities for cyber espionage and cyber attacks might be made available to China in a country that would rely on telecommunications equipment from Huawei or ZTE?
So three quick things. As the Huawei Oversight Board report describes, the quality of the engineering is not great, and so there are a number of vulnerabilities that are left open on the box. So China and other capable actors, Russia, Iran, North Korea, others, could exploit vulnerabilities on the box. So that's one. The second is the update process. The ranking member already talked about pushing updates. If that update comes directly from mainland China, that is potentially a problem given the oversight. And third is the way they manage this equipment tends to be by shipping out Chinese nationals to the host country for hands-on. So you have a physical insider threat as well. So real quick, three threats.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I'll just say finally, in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, I think it's striking that there is no, if I understand correctly, there's no American company that is currently developing the 5G equipment. Is that right? Am I wrong about that, gentlemen? No American company developing this 5G equipment.
No American company does the radio part of it. Other companies do the switching and routing and other portions of it.
Got it. I think that's very striking. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We've got about 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes on the vote. Why don't we do Senator Coons? We'll break. We'll finish up the first vote. Vote early in the second one. I'll come back. So after Senator Coons, we'll take a break, go vote, and resume the hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member. I am grateful that we're holding this hearing and that so many members have participated. If I have a simple point I hope to make, it's that patents really matter in this space. And if in a race to try and address other challenges facing this committee and this country, like, for example, prescription drug prices, which was our most recent hearing, we do unintended harm to our patent system, That will cause significant harm to our race, our company's race, to 5G. I share my colleague's concern about the ways in which China is now developing what will be the most important technological advance of this coming decade. I just returned from leading a congressional delegation to China, South Korea, and the region. 5G's potential to revolutionize our lives and to produce hundreds of billions of dollars in new technologies, new applications, are tantalizing and intriguing, but the very real potential that China will be the winner in this next generation of technology, and that will allow them to both exploit and benefit from and potentially disrupt what will be always on, always present central networks that drive everything from literally our vehicles to healthcare to national security to our power system is chilling and concerning. I'm convinced that our ability to be leaders on the global stage depends on our ability to command the intellectual property heights of 5G. So let me ask you, I was encouraged to hear about the Prague principles, both from the FCC commissioner in a more recent hearing and today. China and South Korea are outpacing the United States in the standard essential patents, the SEPs, that will determine sort of who sets the standards and who benefits from them. We really were the dominant leader in 4G SEPs. What should we be doing to make sure that we become the leader in 5G standard essential patents? How do we challenge China's announced ambitious Made in China 2025 plan to be the dominant force in this? And how central do you think intellectual property and patent licensing will ultimately be to which country or team of countries most benefits from 5G? Director Krebs, and then if you would, Assistant Secretary.
So I consciously avoided patent law in law school. So I'm going to focus on one part of your question. I think what we have to continue to do is identify what the incentives are for American innovation. I think in terms of the radio network devices, as Ambassador Strayer mentioned, there's an ecosystem out there that can support, I think, at least our domestic capabilities. There's a level of innovation that sits above that at the app layer and the things that are going to be enabled. We really need to invest there. Because we're going to get to 5G, broader 5G deployments before anyone else, we have an enormous testbed opportunity here in the U.S. So we're going to be able to drive global innovation, drive global adoption of these things that run on 5G going forward. That's the opportunity space for us as a country.
That's an optimistic read. I will tell you, in my recent visit to China, we've got, 350 million people. They've got over 1.3 billion people. They are very, very rapidly racing to build out as big and robust a 5G set as they can. And the difference in scale in terms of our test bed requires our integration with our open society allies. And that depends on standards and patents, and those being held by American or American-led companies.
My policy recommendations are similar to Administrator Krebs's, and that is that we need to keep pushing the right kind of incentives to get our companies involved in these standards processes so they can get standards essential patents out of them. It's hard work. I mean, it's not just doing the R&D, but then developing consensus throughout the industry that you have the solution, because these processes almost always result in, or are only finished when there's consensus, that is almost unanimity in the room about having the right standards, the right standard to do a particular function.
And one of our core challenges, Senator Hawley suggested a bill I look forward to reading, but that is more of a decoupling approach that says, we're going to build a world where you're either American technology or Chinese technology, and it assumes that it's sort of a binary world, much as we had during the Cold War with the Soviet Union, where technologically we had largely separate economies. My argument would be that that horse left the barn 20 years ago, and that frankly we have fairly thoroughly integrated innovation economies between the United States, China, and the rest of the West. How do we set standards in a way that allows free and open principles for 5G to win out?
Well, at these standards bodies, we need to ensure that they continue relying on the substance and not political direction. As you may know, that the Chinese have encouraged large numbers of people to make contributions. In some cases, we hear paying them to make contributions that kind of water down the overquality of the process. So we can only make sure that the ground rules in those organizations are fair and cause the best ideas to percolate to the top.
Let me just ask a closing question to try and put this in context. 10 years ago, these didn't exist. They weren't widely adopted. And the things that we do, from hailing an Uber to checking our home security system to banking transfers that today are just routine and common, were big advances a decade ago. What you're trying to convey to us, what I've heard in many briefings, is that 5G is two orders of magnitude in terms of speed, content, and the applications will be dramatic and will change a lot of how we live our lives. Should the average Delawarean be concerned about the possibility that Chinese technology will be central to how that data is transferred globally between the United States and Europe, or between the United States and the rest of the world? Should they be concerned about their privacy, about the stability of these networks, and about their security if China ends up holding the winning hand in the development of 5G?
I think there are two ways to answer that. One is, if you stay domestic, yes, there's always going to be a global information ecosystem. The second piece, though, is when you travel, when the average Delawarean travels, they are no longer under the protection of U.S. law.
Right.
They are then subject to the authoritarian demands of China, their technology. That is a significant concern of mine.
Yeah, our citizens shouldn't have any concern within the United States, because our company is going to follow the best practices about management of data. The telcos are building in the best security practices into the systems, and they're not providing the opportunity for a vendor to undermine the entire system.
Last, I heard what I think is a telling insight. We are having a significant disagreement with some of our core allies about backdoors. How big are they? Where are they? How are they designed? We shouldn't take our eye off the larger challenge, which is that right now, China's goal is to build the entire house, and we need to step up our game to make sure that we're part of the framing of the next generation. Thank you for your work, and thank you for your testimony. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We'll adjourn the hearing until after the second vote. I'll go vote, and we'll come back and get started again. Thank you. Okay, who's next? Tillis? Hearing will come to order. Senator Tillis, then we'll have Blumenthal and Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for being here. I wanted to go back and make sure that what we're talking about with talking with our partners, the what we're really trying to do here is make sure that the whole of government understands the risk associated with it. Is that correct? What we're trying to do is make sure that our partners, our allies, understand that they do need to go through a risk-based assessment, and that assessment is most likely going to be not Huawei and something that the United States and our partners are leading on. Is that accurate?
That's exactly what we're asking them to do.
Now, when we talk about the whole of government, how far does that go? Because I, for one, and I, this hearing could as easily be held in Senate Armed Services, to be honest with you, because of the nature of the military threat. Probably at some point we should. When we're talking about the U.S. government, does that requirement extend down to all of our partners and their supply chains or vendors and those who support the U.S. government? What about their infrastructures?
So under Section 889 of last year's NDAA, five companies, Huawei, ZTE, Hytera, Hikvision, federal government dollars, contracting, procurement, grants, anything like that cannot be used to, or other companies beholden to the Chinese state can't be brought into the supply chain. So we are able to extend that. We're working on the regs right now for implementing that process.
What about local governments, state and local governments?
No, sir. State and local governments, do not have that authority, just the system of laws that we have here.
Is it fair to say that if there's any federal dollars flowing down to any IT initiatives or other initiatives, that we can create some nexus saying that those dollars cannot be expended to forward Huawei or a would-be adversary?
That exists right now under the 889 effort. Yes, sir.
And the FCC has an ongoing proceeding where they're considering prohibiting the use of the Universal Service Fund for any high-risk technology vendors.
But state government should understand. I understand you made a point that I think is very important about some of the smaller companies have this economic. I think it's a false economy. I do have a copy of the report from the UK. And if you're taking a look at total cost of ownership, we have to understand what the Chinese are doing here. If they come in and say, we'll do your mess for less, so not only will we sell you the underlying telecommunications equipment, but we'll have our folks come in, stand it up, patch it. I mean, you're literally putting a fox in the hen house. And what we need to do as a matter of state policy is educate, and I will work with our state legislature to have them basically implement at a state level what we're doing at the federal level. That's the only way we can pull these potentially malign technologies out of the whole of government of infrastructure, because when you talk about 5G, I do know a fair amount about it because I've worked in this space for a while. When you start talking about public safety threats, which are a good number of them, are executed at the local level. When you talk about healthcare, underlying healthcare systems, those are all things that are outside of what you're trying to do, but critical to a certain extent, but critical to actually securing this infrastructure. Would you all agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, definitely. And all the people at the value chain that rely on that infrastructure should have a say in what kind of security of vendors and that need to have trustworthiness.
Yeah, I think the other thing that we need to educate members on are that when we talk about 5G, a lot of that is really at the edge of the backbone. So it's the wireless communications that's going to enable a number of things that we want to do. But we haven't really talked about everything moving back up to and including the massive infrastructure that's based on Huawei technology. If you take a look at most of the cloud computing companies based here in the United States, their underlying technology is extensively Huawei based on price points. Hopefully when they see the lifetime cost and the total cost of ownership, they'll start making better long-term decisions. But I think something that we need to do is recognize that if we get the public side of this equation right, and I believe that we will, I think our NATO allies, the EU, will recognize the strategic importance of it, but we still have this great exposure to a highly disruptive latent capability with the private infrastructure still continuing to buy this product, which incidentally is oftentimes based on intellectual property theft from innovators here in the United States, and that's one of the reasons why they can produce it at a lower price point. So I think we've got to do a better job of making sure that the other companies, the members of this economy that have a pull factor for this technology and that they're going into this underlying infrastructure, that's almost as great a threat as what we're trying to do for the whole of government. Would you all agree with that?
Yes, sir. I think the thing that we've not necessarily over-rotated on with 5G, but we do tend to lose sight of, as you mentioned, the backbone. You know, this really does, to a certain extent, start at the water's edge. You have cables, subsea cables, cable landings. Huawei Marine is a big player in that space.
We haven't even talked about the unfair trade practices that China has with fiber technology in this country. We haven't talked about how they would like to diminish or reduce our industrial base for a lot of the backbone components through unfair trade practices. Those are things that hopefully as we move forward, we'll spend time on this committee. This is a very impressive strategy on the part of China, but it is a strategy with multiple tentacles, and we as members of Congress need to understand every one of those and chop them off. Thank you.
Senator Blumenthal.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for holding this hearing, and I agree with Chairman Graham that there seems to be pretty strong bipartisan alarm about the threat posed by Huawei, which is really the threat posed by China. And what still mystifies me is why our partners and allies around the world seem less alarmed than we are. We've been figuratively pounding the table here.
So I see this through two lenses, and I think the second one is where it breaks down a little bit internationally. There's a risk lens. We've talked a lot about that today. You know, we know, we have a very clear understanding of the vulnerabilities associated with their equipment, the intentionality of the Chinese government. We have a unique experience, I think, of being
exploited by
China.
But they've known about these vulnerabilities for years.
Bloomberg
has reported about it. The UK has a powerful report.
So this is where
these sources of information are theirs, not ours.
So this is where the second lens comes through, and that's the economic lens. Is we have to do a better job, I think, as we go out and talk to our partners about the economic life cycle, the life cycle costs of maintaining this equipment. It's not about the upfront. It's not about the financing. It's about over 15 years, the true cost, not just financial, but the intellectual property cost, the availability costs. We need to really, I think, dial in our talking points a little bit more on that, and we're doing it.
But here's the disconnect for me. Even if there were an economic advantage, and you're saying we need to convince them that, in fact, that supposed economic advantage is evanescent and illusory. But even if there were some economic advantage, it is outweighed by the security threat.
I agree with you in principle. I think the concern, though, is some of our partners may not have alternative economic options, whether it's from available, whether it's supply, the manufacturing runs by some of the non-Huawei options may not, you know, we may have bought them all up for the next 5 years. So what we've got to do is continue to push supply, but also we've got to give them some alternative options to getting the good stuff in there.
Should we have, similarly to the UK's National Cybersecurity Center, a review body to audit the foreign telecommunications equipment that this country uses, do you think? Ambassador?
So we think that an after-the-fact kind of review of software will never keep up with the patching and the many millions of lines of source code that are being asked to reviewed. Or any type of certification process can still have hidden vulnerabilities that aren't exposed. So we think relying on those types of certifications never worked. It really comes down to the building trust into the design and security and design of the systems from the very start.
And do you agree with Mr. Krebs that it is the lack of an economic alternative, and by a lack of an economic alternative, I would delete the word economic, because is it really the lack of an alternative that you're saying, a technological alternative? Lack of supply, lack of capacity to produce the equipment that's necessary? Is that what you're saying?
I don't want to pat the United States on the back too much in this, but we've gotten onto this that we need to be thinking about how we roll out telecom with this national security lens. In many other parts of the world, the telecom regulators are not as focused on the national security aspects of the decisions being made, so they're not able to cause those true national security supply chain decisions to be part of the calculus about which vendors they choose.
But here's my thinking, and again, through the lens of the Armed Services Committee and our national defense, we are spending, you know, tens of billions of dollars, literally tens of billions of dollars on aircraft carriers, on new joint strike fighters, all of it potentially more vulnerable because of the kinds of compromising equipment that you were describing. We are literally putting our national security at risk, and ultimately it's theirs as well, because they're buying the same stuff from us, the next generation aircraft, and they're depending on our aircraft carriers, which become sitting ducks out in the middle of the oceans if our communication systems are vulnerable. So shouldn't we be devoting the same kind of investment, if it is an economic, again, to use your word, if it's an economic challenge, that we are doing to all of these bright new shiny objects in the air and on the sea?
I'm not saying it's an exclusively economic decision. What I'm saying is there's a balance between the risk piece and the economic piece, and some countries just don't have an alternative. To your broader point, what we're really speaking to here is a global supply chain challenge where a good bit of the equipment is being manufactured in countries, either offered by or being manufactured in countries that we may not agree with, to put it simply and bluntly. This is the, you know, this is kind of the new cybersecurity, supply chain risk management. Department of Defense is investing a significant amount of time. I know that the acting secretary thinks about this, having heard him speak on this a number of times. We are thinking about this a great deal. This is a significant area of focus going forward.
Well, it is a bad day for China in this hearing room, but really only in this hearing room, because China is going to continue to exploit our vulnerability in the world at large, and somehow the economic force or military force of this country has to be harnessed in favor of expanding that supply chain or doing something to counter this threat, because our pounding the table is not having an effect.
I just think it's also important that we talk to our partners and allies about using creative funding mechanisms so that they can enable their telecom operators to buy what is trusted technology rather than going with what's the cheapest and make those hard national security decisions for themselves.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We've been hacked.
We'll do this. There we go. I apologize for that. Mr. Krebs, I want to go back to something that you said about the long-term cost. Probably with our allies, the most significant long-term cost is if they go with Huawei equipment, they are giving the Chinese control of their information distribution system and an insight into everything that they are going to do, and that's going to be a very expensive cost for them and for freedoms that they cherish. So I hope that they do think about that. I will say this, to me it is important that as we talk about this issue, we talk about having a national strategy, not government control of a 5G network, but a national strategy to approach this. And Senator Cornyn has a good bill that focuses on developing a 5G strategy. That's the right approach. I have legislation that we're introducing today that deals with the supply chain and deals with knowing what those economic threats, those threats are to the supply chain, because that is something that is significant as we talk about the utilization, not only in our commercial space, but in our military space, of a 5G network. And at Fort Campbell, which is primarily located in Tennessee, with our special ops guys, our fifth group, they will all cite 5G as something that is going to be an imperative for them, and they do have concerns. Listening to you all, I think we can kind of wrap up saying there are four legs to the 5G strategy that we need to have. We need to look at siting reform, harmonization of standards, availability of spectrum, and a secure supply chain. Is that where you all, would you all agree with that? Would you add or subtract anything to that?
I think that's generally right. The way we've talked about it, particularly of late, is there's the risk management piece. There's the standards piece and the international cooperation piece. There's the regulatory piece. And then ultimately, there's the economics piece.
I think that's a good summary.
Okay, great. Mid-band spectrum, which is something that we need here. And we are always looking for ways to recoup and to get this spectrum out. The EU, China, South Korea, Japan are all looking at ways to allocate mid-band spectrum. So talk for just a minute about what is being done by some others and then changes we should be making to spectrum policy in order to facilitate deployment of 5G.
The FCC probably best positioned to articulate the vision on the spectrum issue, but I would say it's important that we have spectrum at the low band, mid band, and in the millimeter wave ranges, because each of those types of spectrum has different qualities and characteristics about how far it travels and its ability to carry data in a very fast fashion. So millimeter wave is the best at getting high transmission rates, whereas the mid band can have greater propagation, and low band is typically what we use today in the United States for greater distances. So it's important to have a mix of all three, and I know the FCC is looking at making all three more available.
Anything to add?
No, I'd agree with that. FCC, NTIA, and DOD in particular have done a very good job, I think, lately of coordinating on spectrum release, and look forward to that continuing.
Awesome. Well, thank you all for being here, and I know we're going to have another panel. As we talk about commercial development, and of course, Mr. Krebs, we mentioned Memphis. Verizon is doing a 5G project there. We have some good studies that are being done. FedEx is doing with some work with the same day bot. We've got AT&T in Nashville and some 5G products there. But as we talk about the advancement of AI and AVs and the utilization of these in both the commercial and the military space, getting this right is going to be important. Making certain that we have a strategy in place that frees up free enterprise to innovate in this space is going to be so vitally important. And I thank you all for your time and insights.
Thank you. Senator Feinstein, I think you had a follow-up question.
Thanks very much. I was just reading something called the Huawei Cybersecurity Evaluation Center Oversight Board annual report, and I'd like to read a section to you. It's 3.16. The work of, I don't know what you call it, HCSEC, summarized above, reveals serious and systematic defects in Huawei software engineering and cybersecurity competence. For this reason, NCSC continues to advise the Oversight Board. It's only appropriate to provide limited technical assurance in the security risk management possible for equipment currently deployed in the UK. It goes on to say, poor software engineering and cybersecurity processes lead to security and quality issues, including vulnerabilities. The number and severity of vulnerabilities discovered along with architectural and build issues by the relatively small team in HCSEC is a particular concern. If an attacker has knowledge of these vulnerabilities and sufficient access to exploit them, they may be able to affect the operation of the network, in some cases causing it to cease operating correctly. And then it goes on to other impacts. But from what I read from this official report to the British government, it is a vulnerable system. Would you agree with that?
Yes, absolutely. And it's not just the vulnerabilities there, but it's the ability of the Chinese government to require that company to cooperate with them and talk about the vulnerabilities. If you're going to hack into this iPhone, the best people to ask be the people that designed it. And that's exactly what the Chinese government has access to.
I agree 100%. The last section you spoke to, 3.18, particularly the if an attacker has knowledge of these vulnerabilities, you've got to be cognizant of the fact it says if an attacker, not necessarily Chinese, not necessarily Huawei. That if an attacker could be Russian, Iranian, North Korean, otherwise, if they know about those vulnerabilities, it's a wide open system. So it's not just about a single actor. This is what the NSA references as the bug door. Not the back door, the bug door. Plausible deniability built into the system, poor quality that any knowledgeable actor could take advantage of.
That, see, I've never read anything quite like that about a system.
I love this report. It helps us out significantly. And I think the more people that read this, the better. In fact, meeting with the rural telcos yesterday, I gave every one of them a copy of this report. I said, go read it. If you have any questions, come back and we'll talk.
Well, would your assessment be that this is, I'm concerned about espionage, that this system is more vulnerable to espionage because of vulnerabilities in it as opposed to the exploiter's knowledge and ability?
It'd be difficult, I think, to make a comparative assessment. As I mentioned earlier on, I'm concerned about three things: the quality of the product, the vulnerabilities that are baked into it. Even if you fixed all those vulnerabilities, even if Huawei or whomever else fixed every single vulnerability or issue in this product, you would still have, as you mentioned earlier, the update cycle that is subject to the control of the government of China. So that's the second piece. The third piece is the physical access by the management teams, the nationals that they send out to maintain the system. So at least three concerns, three potential vulnerabilities that could be exploited right there.
So could you quickly just summarize what the status of Huawei is now in terms of its clients, the scope of activity?
Domestically or internationally?
If you could do both, that'd be great.
Domestically, as Ambassador Strayer mentioned, they're generally not present in the big four wireless providers. They are in some of the rural telcos, and the FCC is looking at some of those issues. Generally speaking, they do not have a large presence here in the United States. Internationally, it's a different story, particularly in developing nations. Again, we've talked about the economic factors there, including soft money, financing, things of that nature. You know, it's a pretty enticing offer if you can get to 5G quickly using a fully integrated stack provided by Huawei. Europe is a different story. They are present, but there is tension there, and it's not, you know, a fast lane.
Thank you. Senator Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for your testimony. Earlier this year, I raised concerns about Huawei's infiltration of the Five Eyes intelligence networks. And I raised them with Secretary Pompeo, who replied warning that the network of the Five Eyes partners could be vulnerable and could affect joint mobilization efforts if Huawei hardware and technology was present. As you know, in 2012, the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence warned that mitigating risk from Huawei or ZTE is, quote, virtually impossible. Unfortunately, last month, Britain announced that it would allow Huawei to access non-core parts of its 5G network. Ambassador Strayer, can you assess how Britain's decision impacts Five Eyes?
We're quite concerned that Britain would make that decision in the end. They say they have not made a final decision, but what is leaked out there and in other parts of the world is that there's some ability to just have Huawei present in the radio access network, which is the part that's closest to the consumer. If you were able to disrupt that or to conduct espionage there, you have a significant number of other concerns. So you could stop the ability for critical infrastructure to operate or to interfere with the ability for people to be called up for their troop mobilization. So it's just as dangerous in the remote parts of the network as in the core.
And is it at least possible that Huawei's presence in non-core 5G networks could enable it to directly or indirectly access more sensitive nodes in their telecom network?
Absolutely. That's the difference between 4G and 5G is that 5G is going to more seamlessly integrate the core and the edge. So if you have a privilege at the edge, you're probably going to be able to access the core functions as well.
And what are we doing to ensure that our other intelligence partners don't follow Britain's decision? I hope you're right that that decision is not final and that they reverse it, but what are we doing to ensure that, that others don't follow that?
So we've got this ongoing diplomatic campaign around the world, very active, and particularly with the Five Eyes. So we've got already got Australia last August that said that they will not allow a vendor that is under the potential extrajudicial control of a foreign power. So that would prevent Huawei because of the system in China. We've had a positive decision out of New Zealand, and we're continuing to monitor and talk very closely with Canada and the United Kingdom about the future of their decisions about the 5G network. We've also had a great deal of success in Japan recently as well on this point.
Mr. Krebs, another concern that we hear quite a bit about is China and Chinese companies seeking to exert pressure within standard-setting organizations so that those organizations promulgate standards favorable to Chinese national interests. Can you tell us to what extent is this taking place and what risk does it pose?
So I'm not sure I'm the right person to answer this authoritatively, but you know, I think based on my understanding of the way the standards process works, they are flooding the zone, so to speak. They're putting a significant amount of resources in there, not just you know Chinese companies coming out of China, but other companies out of other countries. But essentially what they're trying to do is set the playing field, to continue this horrible analogy, trying to set the playing field to their advantage so that their technology, their standard, they're already deploying within China. They have a standard developed. They want the global standard to follow their standard. So that's what they're trying to set up for.
And what can we do to prevent that from happening?
It's engage, work with our partners. We talked about that a little bit earlier. Continue to invest in the standards process. Again, I have my own personnel that participate in 3GPP. We just need to continue to invest. NIST does a fantastic job. A lot of our American companies between AT&T, Qualcomm, and others, they have engaged. We are holding, I think we're holding the line, but we can't let up. We have to continue pushing forward.
Another concern, Huawei has research partnerships with several U.S. universities, and the Communist Party of China uses research ventures and talent programs and exchange programs to steal and to transfer sensitive information. Since your testimony last year, have you seen a deeper awareness among American universities about this threat of espionage?
Yes, sir. Part of Chairman Burr and Ranking Member Warner have hosted a number of meetings under the CISI authorities, brought together a range of stakeholders, both technology but also academia. We briefed two different groups of presidents and chancellors and boards of regents and others of America's universities. I've had follow-on conversations with a number of universities on some of their issues. And as a result, I think you've seen, particularly from DOJ and FBI's engagement, particularly with Confucius Institutes and other tactics that the Chinese state is using, there has been a shift. You know, I've talked about how industry is shifting. Our colleges and universities have shifted as well. So just the general risk awareness of network security.
And one final question: should the granting of student visas consider the threat that undergrads or graduate student or postdoc students, particularly from communist China, should it consider the threat of espionage or theft of intellectual property?
It should, and to a certain extent, it does. But you have to keep in mind that on an 18-year-old coming out of mainland China doesn't necessarily have a file in the intelligence community all that clearly. And the second piece is they're not necessarily operationalized at that point. What happens is down the road, the phone call comes, and you know, here I'm sitting with your family. They say, hello, by the way, when you come home next week, why don't you bring home a thumb drive or two with some of your research? That's how the process works.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Thank you both. Excellent job, and we'll now move to the second panel. Thank you both very, very much. Yeah, it would be quick, I hope. These are academic types. I didn't know about it until. Thank you very much. The second panel consists of Mr. James Lewis, Senior Vice President, Director of Technology Policy Program, Center for Strategic and International Studies. Dr. Charles Claney, Executive Director, Human Center for National Security and Technology, VPI. Peter Harrell, Senior Fellow, Energy Economic Security Program, Center for a New American Security. Thank you all. Mr. Lewis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ranking Member Feinstein. In 2003, right after I left government service, I was involved in a classified NSA study on what the United States would do when it was dependent on foreign telecom suppliers. And it turns out that the answer is that we would do nothing. So here we are. I'm glad that you've recognized the severity of the problem. Telecommunications is a strategic industry. Lucent, the last U.S. company in this space, went out of business more than a decade ago. This means we are reliant on foreign suppliers. In turn, though, foreign suppliers are all reliant on U.S. technology. No one could make 5G without Qualcomm, Cisco, Intel, and other leading U.S. companies. China plans to spend more than $100 billion to end this dependence. It hopes to dominate the telecommunications market using Huawei, a company we've heard that has extensive ties to the Chinese government. There's three risks, as you've heard. It provides intelligence advantage if you use Chinese 5G. China has the ability to disrupt telecommunication services. And finally, China's 5G mercantilism threatens global innovation. China intends to dominate 5G. Huawei offers huge discounts to potential customers. It can do that because of government support. Huawei benefits from China's economic espionage. China is also determined to control the international standards process. There is no disagreement among key U.S. partners on the risk of using Chinese 5G equipment. The disagreement is over how to manage this risk. A complete ban works best, as you've heard, but some countries are reluctant to do this and argue that a partial ban is sufficient. The U.S. needs four sets of policies to manage 5G risk. First, it must confront China over its mercantilism. It needs to work with our foreign partners to bring Chinese behavior in line with international practices. This will be difficult because many partners, including key allies, fear Chinese retaliation and look to the U.S. for leadership. The U.S. needs domestic policies, as you've heard, to strengthen its technological base and ensure that 5G is deployed here in a timely fashion, and that we preserve supplier diversity. No phone company, even Chinese phone companies, wants a world where Huawei has a monopoly. Finally, the U.S. must develop the means to communicate securely over global networks that will invariably contain Chinese 5G technology. Huawei property already controls the Africa market. There are other regions where it's dominant. This isn't going to change. 5G is part of a larger contest with China over global influence and the future of the internet. This is not a Cold War, but it is also not the partnership we expected 20 years ago. China wants to displace the United States and change global norms and institutions to serve its interests. We no longer have the luxury of thinking of ourselves as the sole tech superpower. Our policies must adjust to reflect this. They need to expand America's technological strength, improve our ability to innovate, and protect our companies from foreign predatory practices. And this can involve countries other than China. We're at the start of a long struggle to integrate China into a stable international order. This means we need to resist whenever it uses coercive tactics to achieve its foreign policy and economic goals. It means we need to recover the ground lost since the US and allies let China enter the global market without making it change its behavior. 5G is one of the emerging technologies that will frame this struggle. I thank the committee for the opportunity to testify, ask that my written testimony be entered into the record, and look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Graham, Ranking Member Feinstein, and committee members. First, I'd like to highlight that 5G is the most secure wireless technology we've ever developed. It adds additional privacy protections for users, it overhauls back-end signaling with an entirely new set of security standards, and leverages a software-defined philosophy to improve the security of critical applications like smart grid and connected cars that will ride over it. However, as we've discussed, there's looming anxiety over China's prominent role in the development and deployment of the technology. China, and Huawei in particular, has skyrocketed from imitator to innovator over the past decade, now leading global R&D in telecommunications. First and foremost, China's motives surrounding Huawei and ZTE are economic. They represent a digital version of the Belt and Road Initiative, building global influence, particularly in developing countries. As we've discussed, there's this big financial and economic component, and in particular, Huawei and ZTE leverage Chinese policy banks, in particular China Development Bank, to offer very favorable terms on capital investments that helps subsidize the deployment of Huawei and ZTE infrastructure globally. However, this economic dominance creates a number of national security concerns. Independent of Huawei and ZTE, China has sufficient penetration into the global internet that they can re-vector large swaths of traffic in order to enable cyber operations or deny access to the internet. For example, in 2010, China Telecom hijacked 15% of the internet for a total of 18 minutes and was able to route it through Chinese systems. There have been a slate of more focused attacks over the last several years targeting Western governments, news organizations, and financial institutions that have all been launched from Chinese telecom points of presence here in North America. While the FCC may have recently denied China Mobile's license to operate in the U.S., China Telecom has had one for over two decades and uses these points of presence to execute cyber attacks across the internet backbone. Increases in Huawei and ZTE market shares will only give them a larger platform to execute these sorts of attacks in more surgical and less attributable ways. There needs to be consequences for blatant attacks such as this on the backbone of the internet. As we've discussed in the first panel, Huawei router access into a Huawei router or a ZTE base station could allow targeted surveillance, injection of malware, or be used to defeat encryption that underpins the World Wide Web. Essentially, these devices can be stitched into the global internet fabric itself as a botnet. As the U.S. urges allies and partners to eschew Chinese equipment, many want to see the smoking gun of Huawei and ZTE directly supporting the CCP or enabling cyber operations carried out by the PLA. Certainly, Huawei has demonstrated a poor track record when it comes to intellectual property rights, and even giving bonuses to employees specifically for stealing intellectual property from competitors. However, there's little direct evidence that there are security flaws being introduced uniquely into equipment on behalf of the Chinese government, specifically to enable PLA operations. Certainly, the UK's Oversight Board report that we've referenced several times throughout these proceedings points to many poor software engineering practices that could create vulnerabilities available to anyone, including the Chinese government. Also, as was mentioned earlier, keep in mind that through the software update process, vulnerabilities can be introduced after the fact. And as was mentioned, in many parts of the world, Huawei actually operates the equipment on behalf of host nation telecommunications companies. A backdoor is not needed if you already have a key to the front door. So we don't need a smoking gun to know that the risks are intrinsically greater with Chinese equipment due to the Chinese government's role in as a state-owned enterprise, or state-influenced enterprise. So what can the United States do? One of the things that was highlighted earlier in the proceeding is that we need to focus on 5G applications. To a certain extent, the 5G standards are already baked, and the opportunity to really influence things is the applications that ride on top of 5G. 5G provides unique services that can create slices of the internet for these critical services. And research and development can be research and development should focus on how to design these slices to achieve added levels of security for applications such as connected cars and smart grid. Critical infrastructure sector-specific agencies should develop pilots, best practices, and policies around the 5G applications that will our critical infrastructure will rely on. Second, the U.S. needs to make investments now in research and innovation to ensure U.S. leadership in 6G. Each generation of wireless technology takes around 15 years to mature from early stage research to ultimate deployment, and the 6G clock started a few years ago. Agencies like the National Science Foundation and DARPA should start investing now. We should also look at launching a major 6G initiative similar to the EU's 5G public-private partnership, which was launched in 2013, leveraging 700 million euros in public funding against more than 3.5 billion euros in industry investment. This initiative was the fuel that really organized Europe in a coherent direction and ultimately defined what 5G is today. The US should launch a similar initiative focused on 6G, and if we don't do so in the next couple years, China will. Thank you for the opportunity to address the committee today, and I look forward to your questions.
Mr. Harrell.
Mr. Chairman, Madam Ranking Member, thank you for the opportunity to testify today. It's a privilege to be here on such a distinguished panel. I have submitted a written statement for the record that I ask be entered into the record. Rather than simply summarizing that statement, I thought I would use my introductory remarks to make a couple of discrete comments on issues that were raised during the first panel earlier this morning. First, as I think came out through the first panel, the success for the United States in the race to 5G will depend ultimately primarily on the investments we make here in the United States. Well, as my colleagues on this panel have stated, it is undeniably true that Huawei has benefited from a variety of unfair and at times illegal Chinese state financing, economic espionage, and other illegal practices. We also need to recognize that Huawei is itself a formidable competitor, as is China. Huawei spent $15 billion last year in R&D spending, ranking at number 5 among all technology companies globally. It has 15% of the standard essential patents related to 5G technology, an issue that Senator Coons brought up earlier. And it offers a product that, as has come through today, many foreign companies and governments find quite attractive, both on price, but also because it can be rolled out quickly and operates commercially. Ultimately, unless the United States makes the investments here at home to develop better technology, and in particular, to lead in the development of the technologies that sort of will be built around 5G, as Assistant Secretary Krebs said, we are not going to win this race. Well, it is important we confront China internationally. We need to focus at least as much on the investments we make here at home. On that note, I would like to commend recent steps by the FCC and the Trump administration to try to speed the deployment of 5G technology here in the United States and to encourage investment. Earlier this year, last month, the FCC announced one of the largest auctions of spectrum in history, which will occur later this year across a range of different bands that can be used by 5G. And the FCC also took regulatory steps to ensure that the many tens of thousands of actual towers that need to be built domestically to roll out 5G can be built without facing extensive local government regulation. Second, I want to comment on the espionage threat, which has come up repeatedly throughout this hearing. It is abundantly clear to all of us here in the United States and to many of our allies that Huawei equipment presents a very serious espionage threat, both in the United States and to our allies. And I do not need to repeat the many statements that my colleagues on this panel, and Assistant Secretary Krebs and others have made. The only point I would make, if we think about espionage and Chinese espionage here in the United States writ large, yes, 5G and Huawei's Development of technology and deployment of technology globally is a significant espionage threat. But I think we also need to think about the espionage threat posed by another issue of interest to this committee, which is the fairly low standards of data privacy here in the United States. We spend a huge amount of effort thinking about the risk of Chinese hacking, which is a very real risk and a growing risk that must be addressed. It is also quite possible for commercial actors, including Chinese front companies, to simply purchase vast quantities of Americans' personal data, which they can then exploit for espionage purposes. I would urge members of the committee to think about data privacy as a national security issue as well as a domestic policy issue. Finally, I'd like to make a closing remark on the international diplomatic campaign that Mr. Steyer talked about on the prior panel. I commend the Trump administration's recent 6 months of diplomacy globally to try to make clear to foreign governments what the stakes are and the costs that countries will face if they deploy Huawei equipment at scale. However, I agree with Dr. Krebs' statement that we also need to be thinking about ways for foreign companies to deploy non-Huawei equipment rapidly and at scale. For many of these countries, particularly in Europe, they have very stark memories of having fallen behind the United States in the deployment of 4G, and as a result, lacked much of the innovative ecosystem that has served the U.S. so well. And I think they are reluctant to slow down the deployment of 5G overseas because of the long-term economic costs they face. So we need to be thinking about what can we do to help our allies speed the deployment of non-Huawei 5G, even as we continue to draw the contrast between Huawei equipment and non-Huawei equipment. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much. So as I understood the first panel, it seems to be the policy of the United States is to tell our allies that when it comes to purchasing 5G programs or material or 5G systems, there are certain criteria that we want you to meet before you purchase. Did y'all get that? Everybody said yes. Okay. Part of the criteria is to change the communist Chinese government. Seems to me that one of the concerns we have is the way China does business. Do you agree with that? So we're telling the world, basically, you can't buy Huawei communist Chinese owned equipment, even if it's a private company, and still have the same business national security relationship with the United States as you did before. Is that an accurate statement? Okay. Seems to me we have. Aren't we telling them if you buy these systems, you'll be shut out of intelligence sharing?
Senator, I might take that one. I don't think we've been that blunt just yet. I think we have.
I think that's the, maybe I misread the first panel. Do you get that, Mr. Clancy?
So I think we like to approach it through the lens of risk management because that allows us to not single out specific countries or specific companies. Well, I think the effect is perhaps the same.
Yeah, so the effects, the point is, I'm trying to do two things here. Bring clarity. If you're an ally of the United States, we're pretty much telling you that if you buy these systems, your relationship with the United States is going to change fairly dramatically. Then you bring up problems, and the other panel did also, that we're not giving people very good alternatives, and they're not going to stay stuck in time forever. So there's two things I've gotten out of this hearing. I support the policy of the United States to tell allies, don't go down this road with China. But I also think it's incumbent upon us as Congress to push alternatives that will not trap our allies into old systems that will actually advance the cause for all of us. Does that make sense? Is that our two goals here, Mr. Harrell?
I think those are the fundamental two goals of U.S. policy here.
Mr. Clancy?
I agree.
So the problem we have, I must be the problem child on the panel, so I apologize, Mr. Chairman. Huawei's already all over Europe, and the 4G networks the Europeans use depend on Huawei. It's too expensive to rip it out. That's part of why they're balking. And to Mr. Harrell's point, you can deploy 5G faster if you layer it over 4G initially. So we're going to need to hold the line, but it's not going to be black or light. It will be a path to get them to move away from Huawei.
Do you
not let them use it for 5G.
Do you agree with the concerns expressed in terms of our national security that if they do deploy 5G Chinese technology, that the concerns we've all talked about are real?
Huawei's been a problem for its whole existence, so okay. Yes.
So I don't know what to do other than just try to find a way to move forward. Pretty clear to me that as long as China is China, we feel threatened in this space. And we're telling our allies, don't go down this road. Don't make us pick between doing business with you and having to compromise our systems. Seems to me that this should be a national security economic priority of the Congress and the Trump administration. And with that, Senator Feinstein.
I'm reluctant to say this because I don't have the knowledge that all of you do, but it's my understanding that part of the difficulty is that Huawei equipment is 20 to 30% cheaper and often comes with generous leasing or loan terms. So Huawei is able to offer lower prices because of support from the Chinese government. I believe that's a fact. I don't know how we fight the 5G situation, but it seems to me that the learning lesson ought to be taken up by 6G, and that we ought to understand that the world we're playing in is a very difficult world. I don't think if a country in Europe can get 5G for 30% less than in the United States, they see a necessary incentive not to do that. But I would hope that as people look at the next generation, we approach it differently, learn from the problems here. Would you comment on that, Mr. Lewis, and then have the others comment?
Yes, thank you, Senator. I was talking to an executive from a European telco that was involved in a bidding process with Huawei, and he said that they offered them close to a 90% discount, and I'll use his words, because they were desperate to get into our telecommunications core. So we can make assumptions that are reasonable about why Huawei is desperate and where they're getting the money. I think that you can make the political case that Chairman Graham has laid out, that this is not something that you can do without risk. China has a massive global espionage campaign, and if you use Huawei, it will only accelerate that.
Excuse me.
Thank you. Gesundheit.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll note that the free hand of a capital market doesn't work well in the face of a heavy hand of industrial policy, and that's what we're facing right now, is how do we maintain our view of not picking winners and losers here in the United States, and in terms of federal subsidies, and be able to compete against an adversary who is doing that. I think your point about 6G is excellent. I think that's a big starting point in terms of where we need to make investments now, and not necessarily in the same top-down, heavy-handed way that you see in China, but I think there's investments in R&D that could create an environment where the U.S. Emerges as a leader in the patents that are so critical to the standards process. That could then form the basis of 10 new startup companies that could one day compete with Huawei.
I just want to pick up on a beginning of a comment that Dr. Clancy made around ways to push back on China's industrial policy, which, as I say, is one of the factors that is giving Huawei an advantage here. I do not want to dismiss Huawei as a competitor, but one of the factors is clearly below market lending and IP theft and a variety of unfair practices. Clearly, this week, we have an ongoing trade negotiation with China, given that the Chinese and the Trump administration administration did not reach a trade agreement last week, and President Trump has increased tariffs on China. We don't know where that trade negotiation will go. But certainly that is a vehicle that the administration can and should be using to push for really fundamental reforms on this kind of Chinese industrial policy writ large, of course, but maybe very specifically with respect to Chinese 5G and telecommunications rollout generally.
Senator Whitehouse.
Thanks, Chairman. And to the panel for being here. Cars are very dangerous things, and they kill lots and lots of people, but they're super high utility pieces of equipment, so we put airbags and seatbelts in them and we use them. Bazookas don't quite have the same danger to utility, so we forbid those. So question one is Chinese 5G more like a car or more like a bazooka? Can you safety around it, or do you need to try to prevent it?
I'll go first, Senator, and hello. In talking to some of our NATO allies, they would tell you that 5G does expand the possibility of Chinese espionage, which is already rampant in their countries. They also expressed...
But back to my question, car or bazooka, is it something you can add safety features and deal with and we should put up with it?
No.
Okay. Cars or bazookas, Dr. Clancy?
I guess I would go with bazooka in that the effects of a cyber attack are nonlinear. With cars, the safety issues are linear. They affect individual vehicles and the passengers of those vehicles who are making informed risk decisions, in theory, about what to drive and how to drive. You don't have that with a global telecommunications infrastructure.
Mr. Harrell? You're not plugged. You're not mic'd up.
Apologies. When I look at how foreign governments look at this issue,
I don't want a peroration, just an answer.
I think that for me, it's a bazooka. But for most foreign governments looking at this, it's a car.
Yeah.
And I think that's sort of a fundamental issue that we have to grapple with.
So let me ask each of you, and just because your name is Clancy, let me start with you. What is a plausible worst case scenario that we would face from the 5G Huawei risk?
I think a worst case scenario is part of a global conflict. China is able to completely control the internet and fundamentally cripple our ability to do command and control in major combat operations.
Dr. Lewis?
Thank you. The worst case scenario would be Huawei dominance, which would damage our ability to be innovative, and Chinese control of the telecom networks that would allow them to disrupt critical services.
They could start writing programs and code and conducting their business in such a way that American companies were effectively frozen out or disadvantaged.
The 4G leadership we had in innovation might shift to China. That would be a worst case.
Okay. And Mr. Harrell?
I agree with Dr. Lewis. I think the worst case is China dominating the whole ecosystem that will emerge around 5G.
It's an economic more than a national security risk, or at least that's the immediate risk.
That is the immediate risk. The national security risk is real, particularly with the denial that Dr. Clancy talked about. That said, I think that probably there are going to be ways to at least partially engineer around some of that risk so that you wouldn't see the total shutdown in a worst-case scenario.
Great. Let me just close out with an appreciation to CSIS for the work that they've done in this space. They had a brief lapse of judgment and let me be the Democratic co-chair of their latest cyber report before President Trump was inaugurated. They do a report to the incoming president. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem to have much effect because I don't think the administration has come to us with any legislation. But I can't resist seeing Dr. Lewis here, both to express my appreciation and also to express my hope, because Chairman Graham has been very thoughtful and attentive and interested in these issues, that we can find a way to break the logjam to address the larger cybersecurity issues, and potentially the 5G is a piece of that, with some legislative package. And what stops us is nothing of any merit. What stops us is, I think General Alexander used to say, I think he was exaggerating, but he used to say, I respond to 137 congressional committees on cyber. So even if it was only 37 instead of 137, that's still probably 35 too many. So we get into a bollocked up system in the Senate where as soon as one committee pops up and says, I'm going to do something, the committee staff from the other committee say, oh, no, you're not. That's our territory. Even if they're not doing anything, it's the proverbial dog in the manger problem. And so we get all jammed up. And then on the other side, we had a kind of a happy moment when Tom Bossert was over there, who I think was a very solid pro. And we had Dan Coats, our former senator. And I thought, well, there you got substance and politics, and we'll get something going. But nothing organized has emerged out of this administration to deal with cyber legislatively. And that's really a shame, because somehow or other, there is a gap here. I think the chairman would agree. There is a gap here, and we need to fill the gap. And whether CSIS can help us do that, or whether the chairman's leadership can help us do that, or whether the administration will finally decide that they're going to do something legislatively on this, somehow we've got to use a phrase the chairman used in another circumstance, cross the Rubicon here and get to drafting strong bipartisan cybersecurity legislation. Thanks, Chairman.
Well, thank the panel. I just echo what Senator Whitehouse said. I'm by no means an expert, but Senator Whitehouse really understands the threats we face from cyber attacks. So a couple of years ago, we tried to incentivize the private sector to harden critical infrastructure in a fashion that if you met the best business practices and you invested and you actually did the things to protect your infrastructure, you'd be given liability protection. We all believe the regulatory system is not going to be able to keep up with the threat. So you've got hardening our critical infrastructure here at home that's mostly private sector based. Now we've got developing technology called 5G that if China dominates this market, we may not be able to do normal business or function militarily. And we're sitting around looking at each other. We've got a bunch of bills being introduced, but it's going to take administrative leadership. It's going to take the Trump administration working with the Congress to deal with both problems. So I promise Senator Whitehouse that we'll restart the conversation about how to harden critical infrastructure here at home, understanding the private sector is our best bet. They just have to do it meaningfully. And when it comes to the 5G problems that we're facing, it's just not enough to tell our allies, no, we're going to have to do more. We've got to offer a better alternative than what that China has on the table. Thank you. We'll leave the hearing open to receive information, a letter I think Senator Feinstein wants to introduce, and we'll leave it open for input for the next 3 days. Thank you.